and opportunities, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association, Alumni Career Services, and the Georgetown HR and Recruiting Alumni Group. My name is Sarah Hay, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Zachary Johnson, CEO and co-founder of Syndio, an enterprise people analytics company based in Chicago that I'll tell you more about in a moment. And Zachary is great friends with one of our GUAA board members, Christina Carey, so he is a friend of the Hoya community. And before I turn it over to Zach, I want to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and you can access the replay of this webinar within 2 business days on our YouTube channel. To access that, simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services, or you can visit the link that I've sent out directly in the chat area, youtube.com/GeorgetownACS, and on that archive, you can find over 360 past sessions. Or dial into the provided. You are not required to have a headset, but are welcome to use one. But if you're experiencing technical difficulties and you're listening through your computer speakers, that can be caused by having multiple software applications open. So you can close some of those applications or simply join us on the conference line that's provided in your reminder email and on the control panel. Questions are welcome. Zach is planning to take as many questions as time allows during the Q&A portion at the end of the presentation. So simply type in your questions into the question area on the control panel. I will email everyone a copy of the presentation deck. Let me tell you, Zach has some great content here, and I really like the way he's done his slides. So don't worry, you can look through all of that again and follow along on the webinar archive. And if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible, or visit the GoToWebinar support page. And without further ado, I'll tell you a bit more about Zach. Zachary Johnson, as I said, is the CEO and co-founder of Syndio, an enterprise people analytics company based in Chicago. Syndio uses a network-based approach to help organizations measure the critical intangibles of employee success, innovation, collaboration, and trust. Armed with this data, Syndio's customers find, mobilize, and deploy their best people to solve mission-critical challenges. As CEO, Zach has bootstrapped the growth of Syndio from a one-man shop to a 14-person team with greater than 100% year-over-year revenue growth for the past 3 years. Syndio customers include the world-class organizations like Procter & Gamble, Mars, and Exelon. For this work, Zach and Syndio have been prominently featured in Inc., The Wall Street Journal, and many other publications. In addition to working with for-profit clients, Syndio has focused extensively on applying its unique solution to the challenges of some of the world's largest nonprofits and NGOs. In collaboration with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Zach led work centered on secondary education and post-secondary education in the U.S. and on family health in India. Through this work, Zach helped the foundation use networks to structure the best rollout strategy for driving diffusion of family health innovations across rural Bihar. So we're thrilled to have Zach here today to discuss this topic. It's a little bit over my head, and that's why I thought he definitely needed to be here today and explain it to us. I know employee engagement is something we're all struggling with and training our managers. So Zach, thanks for being here. I'll turn it over to you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I really appreciate the incredible intro. Good afternoon, everyone. I really appreciate you taking the time out of your days to learn about people analytics. It's a topic that I'm incredibly passionate about. It's something that I think it's safe to say that it's coming. And when you look at how companies currently measure employees, there's huge gaps in where we are today and where we're going to be based around capability, based around need, based around employee desire, and all these forces are moving us towards a world where the same way we measure employees, the way we measure employees is going to look a lot more like how we measure customers today in a digital world. So what I want to do is take you through a few things. So discuss some of the problems that exist and how people analytics are going to help them. I want to talk a little bit about what are people analytics and what are some of the things you need to know to understand them. And I want to spend a little bit of time particularly talking about social networks and how they impact measuring employees. From there, we'll talk a little bit about how it works and particularly the approach that we take towards it. I can talk about the approach other people take towards it too. But then lastly, go through some really cool examples of how they've been used in practice. And throughout, what we'll do is I can take questions at the end, but if you have any in the meantime, I'm going to keep an eye on it just so I can make sure we're diving deep enough. And also what we'll do is give you a little bit of information on how you can get started yourself on this with your own organizations, either as an individual or as someone who's managing lots of other people. And we'll talk to you about like some of the risks, opportunities, threats of this in the workplace. So should be fun, should be pretty broad-based. It's going to raise a lot of questions. Generally what we find is some of the questions you'll have early on will get answered later in the presentation. So just hang tight if there's something you're not sure of. We can always loop back and cover it. So I want to kick off with a story about one of my all-time favorite companies, Blockbuster Video. And I'm sure it's been a little while since you've seen this logo, although it's funny, I was actually at Second City the other day in Chicago, which you may be familiar with. It's where like half the people from SNL came out of, and they have a joking giant Blockbuster logo in one of their stations about to open. But Blockbuster had like almost like a virtual monopoly on video rentals for a very long time. At the height of Blockbuster's popularity, they had like 60,000 employees, so a lot, and they had, I think it was about 9,000 to 10,000 physical locations you could rent from. And if you remember back, I know I did, I rented Terminator 2 like 100 times from Blockbuster, it was like $4 to $5 for one rental for 2 to 3 days, right? Imagine if you had to pay $4 to $5 every time you streamed a video from Netflix now, right? It was crazy margins. They had, they made a lot of money. Their brand was ubiquitous, like most of you probably recognize the logo. They had the brand, they had people, they had money, they had deals with content distributors and the licensing companies. I mean, this company was indestructible. Today, Blockbuster doesn't even exist. It's not like Vinyl Records where there's a couple Blockbusters around and it's ironic or funny or niche. No, there is no more Blockbuster. There's not a single store. The company was dissolved. You're looking at a fall from grace that's unbelievable. And when you look back at the causes behind this, it wasn't that they had, you know, a bad product. It wasn't that they had a bad business even. It came down to how the company responded to its external environment and how people weren't able to come together to leverage the resource they had to stay ahead of the curve. Right, like here's an example. In the year 2000, Blockbuster had the opportunity to buy Netflix for $50 million and pass it on. Crazy, right? We would have a totally rewritten history around what we do when we hang out at home and binge watch shows. It's unbelievable because you had so many smart people, you had all this money, all this resource, but it couldn't mobilize to get stuff done. When you think about business, business is three levers: people, process, and technology. Technology you can buy, but you need people to implement it. Process you can whiteboard, but you need people to make it happen as well. It all comes down to people. And Blockbuster is not alone, right? You've got an org that just couldn't innovate fast enough. Then you've got Radio Shack, right? You've got Tower Records. You have CompUSA. You've got Borders. All these businesses that had so much power and so much going for them have lost the war because they didn't have the right people and those people couldn't work together effectively. So why people analytics? Well, the challenge is when you have lots of people, it's just really hard to work at scale. Like, I don't care if you have six friends and you're at dinner and you're trying to split the tip, or if you leave GE and have, you know, several hundred thousand employees, it's hard to get people to work together when you have lots of them. You have personalities that clash. You have poor communication, you have competing goals, you have incentive structures that don't drive the things you want. It's just difficult. The biggest thing, though, that's holding organizations back from getting really good at this is how they think about the world. Today, organizations tend to think about the world like this, where you have people who, you know, you have your organizational hierarchy. You have, like, your CEO or your vice president of Division X. You have people who report to he or she, and then it goes down the row, down the row, down the row until you're at the bottom of the totem pole. This is when we think about corporate America. Way of thinking about things. Like, you need to have division of labor. You need to have roles and responsibility. You need to have people who delegate, because otherwise nothing would get done. The problem is, though, most organizations, when you look at day-to-day work and how things really get done, look a lot more like this, where certain people by virtue of their personality, maybe their position in the network, where they physically exist in space, like which office they're in, et cetera, they just happen to have a bigger impact on how stuff gets done. It's a flat organization, right? Even if you're the CEO, you're still talking to 10 people who talk to 10 other people, talk to 10 other people, and you're part of a vibrant network. So when you look at how companies currently measure people, so if we were to call it like people analytics today, they pretty much just measure those people absent of all those lines in this diagram. They look at tenure. They look at someone's schooling or experience. They look at someone's performance rating, which oftentimes is heavily biased because it comes from a boss who may or may not like them, right? It's not always completely objective. You've got traditional sentiment ratings, so whether it's change readiness assessments, engagement scores, and most of you who are familiar with engagement scores know them as, you know, a 10 to 12 question survey or maybe a little bit longer that you answer about yourself. So we're in a world where we're looking at people strictly as individuals, but we know through our own work and experience that it doesn't work that way. We know that work's all about who do you help, who do you share new information with, who do you motivate on a daily basis. It's also who's a pain in the ass, who's slowing stuff down, who's keeping communication from getting from one group to another. So our fundamental model today of how we measure and incentivize and decide what to do with talent just doesn't reflect the reality of day-to-day work. So when you look at the landscape right now, you have more companies who are more competitive for talent than ever before. You have a bunch of those big companies like your Blockbusters, et cetera, who died because they weren't able to keep up with the pace of things. You have a workforce that's aggressively looking for more opportunities to succeed and be able to earn more. There's all these forces coming into play that's going to force organizations to have to become more efficient about how they manage people, how they hire people, how they retain people, and how they get folks to work together inside organizations. And people analytics is going to be the vanguard of this. So people analytics, the way that we view it is it's the combination of relational analytics and HR analytics. So HR analytics are all those individual metrics that we were just going through. So that's your performance rating, that's your salary or pay grade, that's your tenure, the things you normally look at when you're looking at an individual. Relational analytics, those are the relationships between people. It's who trusts you, it's who gets advice from you, it's who sees who to be a leader. And when you combine the two together, it allows you to not only know who's really good at something, but how much impact is that going to have on the organization. For example, if we do like a change readiness assessment, and for those of you who may not be familiar with it, or actually let's use engagement as an example. When you're looking at engagement, generally people fall on a spectrum from highly engaged to not so engaged. And there's lots of research about how engagement impacts profitability of companies, employee retention, all these things. In a nutshell, pretty much all companies want to have more engaged employees as opposed to less engaged employees. By itself, if you know who's engaged and who's not engaged, you can create a bunch of plans for each division based on which ones are high engaged. Those are its maintenance plans. If it's low engagement, then it's turnaround plans and improvement plans. But how do you know where to focus your time, right? Because when you think about engagement, engagement's contagious. If you show up to work one day and the person you talk to every day in the morning had a really bad night and didn't sleep and they're feeling really sour, that might affect, it might impact your mood. It might make you have a bad day as well. Especially if it's the person you usually go to for help, support, whatever, if they're not feeling very well or they're downright cranky, those factors are contagious. So when you pair up engagement data with influence data, and I can talk a little bit about how we do influence, or how we measure influence, now you have something really powerful. If a division in your company has high engagement scores and a very high influence, that's going to be contagious. Lots of people are going to see that. The impact of that group can be felt far beyond its members. On the flip side, if you have a highly influential group who has very low engagement, that's the first group you're going to want to target with your interventions, because that attitude that's happening there or the prevailing thought and sentiment towards the organization is very likely to hop to other groups because they already have the connections and relationships. So when you pair up these influence and relational level metrics with those individual ones, it can help you figure out some pretty important things. So I want to talk a little bit and dig in on the relational piece, because it's something that folks aren't as familiar with, but once you get it, it's hard not to think this way. So there's a pretty much infinite ways that you can measure an individual person, right? And there's your usual suspects like, you know, age, gender, race, et cetera, like all the different demographics you could have. Then there's sentiment. So how do you feel about your job? How happy are you? How likely are you to look for something new? You can prescribe numbers to pretty much any of these things, and that's the typical way of measuring people. You can do the exact same thing for the relationships between them. So whether or not two people know each other, that's binary, right? They know each other or they don't. It's a 0 or 1. Are they friends, though? Are they family? Are they coworkers? Does one report to someone else? Does the other one someone subordinate? On a scale from 1 to 10, how much do you trust me? Right? On a scale from 1 to 10, how good do you think I am at applied network analysis? There's different metrics you can do, and all sorts of sources we can get it from. So when people do this type of analysis, us included, we generally get it from two main sources. The first is we actually survey people and do and ask them who their relationships are. So I'll walk through in a second, but we send out a survey where you have a list of everybody in the company, and you can go and actually pick who are the top 10 to 15 people who impact my work, and then provide specific relational data about them. People have an idea of who they connect to in their brain, and when you ask lots and lots of people and combine it together, that gives you that network map like this that we had before, where you can literally see who's connected to who and be able to measure it. Additionally, when you're collecting that data, you can look at digital sources as well. So depending upon your company's privacy tolerance, it's possible to have those relationships be emails that are sent, or whether or not you're CC'd on something. If you're in the NSA, it's your phone calls, email, text message, any digital communication you have. Literally, this is the stuff that the NSA uses to find terrorists. It's beginning to be used in the workplace to understand who are the highest impact employees who you absolutely cannot afford to lose. So by grabbing that data from a combination of the digital sets and the survey sets, and then combining it with that HR data, you start to get a pretty powerful model of how this stuff all works. And what does that allow you to do? So there are several different organizational challenges that you can tackle these problems. One of which is retention, another one's driving large-scale transformation, another one's driving innovation. Pretty much anything we need to figure out which people do I need to work on what, that's where a people analytics network-based approach works really, really well. Generally, the way that most organizations are going about doing it, the way we focused our stuff, is comparing within organizations, comparing between organizations, and tracking over time. So what we find is allows us to, when we're collecting data on who trusts who and who shares information with who, we can literally rank order every single employee in every single function, unit, site, division, etc. by those scores, right? So we can create an innovator score based on what people say about each other for sharing new ideas and sharing information. Now you can rank order every single employee based on who goes to them. It's sort of like crowdsourcing each person's score from the rest of the organization. By comparing within the organization, now you know and which in a room to increase the likelihood of having the best brainstorm. It also allows you to begin to see how efficient you're spending capital, and I'll go into that a little bit too. Comparing between organizations, this is where this stuff gets really, really powerful. So today, we're still at the beginning, like the early stages of people analytics. We start measuring employees at this level of detail. As more and more companies do this, we're going to be able to establish some absolute scores for things before that we would just eyeball. So for instance, some of our customers come to us and say, you know, we feel like we're a very siloed organization. People in marketing don't talk to people in sales, they don't talk to people in engineering or R&D or all these different groups. But there's no universal benchmark for siloing. As we measure this year over year in all these different organizations, we're getting to the point where you can start with an organization within 30 minutes of getting their data, being able to tell them that they're actually really good at communicating compared to everyone else, or you know that they're like the worst organization we've ever seen. That's cool because we're doing it in terms of communication, we're doing it in terms of talent and how accurately money is being, or how having a really large Latino population, and they do. When you look at the demographics, the large percentage of their business is they're Latinos. But when you map the network, you see a huge cluster of Latinos speaking together and communicating together in the organization. And then you see a bunch of white people, all the managers in the white people group. So they have high diversity but low inclusion. Now, how does that compare to every other org? That's where the comparative analytics come into play. We can go in and actually tell an organization, how well are you doing against the industry norms, against the overall norms, and be able to actually have those sticks in the ground for performance in HR and those other roles. So tracking over time, this is the other part that's really cool. Right now, organizations, when you look at it from an HR perspective, the metric that tends to be considered the most important is engagement, because there are those comparisons between orgs with whichever vendor you're working with. So they can point and say, we've improved 2% on engagement because we did better than last year, we've surveyed every year, we can see the trends. Same thing with these scores. As you track them over time for your own organization, you can figure out, are we actually becoming more inclusive? Are we sharing power and opportunity with millennial employees who need it in order to stay? Are we empowering people who have the ability to really contribute a lot to the organization? That's where this gets really, really exciting. So the process that most companies tend to take is data collection, data analysis, and embedding in workflow. The data collection can be either digital, so the digital sets we talked about, or in our case, like we do the relational mapping piece, which is survey-based. That's the next slide, so I'll show you what that looks like. Then there's data analysis. Sometimes data analysis, it's out of the box, right? So like our tool, for instance, about 75% of the analytics we do is instantly created in our dashboard. But a lot of times we'll do custom data analysis outside. A really good example of a firm who's like this similar model is Palantir. Palantir tends to do this looking at like external data, but people are copying that model and doing it internally, where if your team says, hey, we really want to know how much money we're spending on XYZ and how that relates to competency of employees, now there are firms who are beginning to be able to take that data and solve pretty much any problem you want. Lastly, and by far the most difficult part, the thing that holds this back from becoming a really huge market opportunity, is embedding this data in existing workflows. And what I mean by that is, one of the questions we get a lot is, all right, so we have this data, now what do we do with it? Right? How do we take it and make it something that's actionable? So it's making sure that every year when you do performance reviews, every employee gets scores back telling them where they exist in the social fabric, so their social scores. It's every time you find your high potential employees, it's making sure you use that peer-to-peer data to be able to figure out who they are. It's every time you have a change initiative, making sure that you're looking at change agents based on the numbers and not just who your team likes to work with. And we're beginning that with some of our customers, and we're seeing more and more companies begin to adopt these approaches in the work that they're doing. So one thing I'd like to talk about real quickly is the survey model, because when you look at this, one of the challenges that a lot of companies have right now is simply data quality. So do we have data that's good enough to analyze and make decisions off of, right? So if you feel like you have bad personnel data, how are you supposed to analyze that and then decide whether you're going to hire, promote, or fire somebody off of it? What we're finding is most of the customers we're working with, we work with orgs ranging from like, you know, the healthcare service corporation who owns half the Blue Cross Blue Shields accounts in the U.S., to Exelon, who owns the most nuclear reactors, to hospitals and airports. We've done all sorts of different types of organizations. And generally, the digital systems are pretty bad. So anyone who's freaking out about my email and text messages and things like that, generally that stuff doesn't happen often, because we go into a company who's been around for 100 years, and even though they're one of the biggest providers of, let's say, like health insurance, they, you know, they're still using Lotus Notes. So it becomes very difficult from an operations standpoint to get the data, to analyze and make it actionable when the data is in poor form. This is where surveys come in the future profiles. The survey model, it's different than normal surveys because instead of answering about yourself, you're actually answering about other people. So you go in, you'll see literally a list of everybody who works at your company. You can filter and sort through to see by department, by division, by job title, what have you, and you pick like the 10 or 15 people who have the biggest impact on your work. Once you have those people, then you're providing positive data about them. So does this person you pick inspire you? Do you collaborate? Do they share information with you? Are they usually an idea generator? Do they lead by example? When we talk about social relationships, we're not talking about who's your friend or who do you spend time with. It's really pithy things that are indicators of trust, information sharing, collaboration, the relationships that help or hinder things in the workplace. When we get that data, it's unique because it really allows us to crowdsource each person's individual scores. So if I don't take the survey, but 20 people go to me as someone who shares new ideas, even without me providing anything about myself, we have a pretty good idea that I am a strong innovator or idea sharer. On the flip side, if I answer about 15 other people, but no one answers about me, my scores aren't going to be very high, even though my data is going to help other people. It's just, it's about what people say about you. So it makes it very hard to cheat this, which is a perennial problem when it comes to engagement surveys, is are people being honest about the data they have? So this is a powerful approach where folks actually like doing it. Like generally, we see response rates with us at least from around 50 to 80+% where people really like praising other people, and then they'll go and run around the org and say, hey, I picked you, you should take a look at this, maybe pick me. And because you're limited in the number of people you can pick, folks tend to treat this with pretty serious gravitas. And it's exciting because it gives employees an opportunity to praise folks when they otherwise don't, and it gives us data that's typically left out of the process that bosses, when they're evaluating employees, tend to use intuition for, like, can this person lead other people? Is this person a good listener? Does this person have access to new ideas, innovation, et cetera? We're actually able to quantify it based on this data. And the analysis we do, just to give you a sense of how that works, this is all based on academic social network analysis. These types of methodologies have existed for a long time. So actually some of the first work was done in the 30s where a gentleman tried to actually map all of New York City by hand. He didn't finish. It was kind of a crazy experiment, but the lore around that has been around this area of study. And what's cool is it's actually very similar to how Google does PageRank. So the same way that you do search results, just looking at networks and how many links websites get, that's the same way that people analytics companies are beginning to look at people in organizations. Who are the go-to people? Who connect otherwise disconnected groups? Who are the folks who, if they're removed from the network, make it impossible for other people to ever meet, communicate, collaborate, etc.? And I'll show you a diagram that helps to illustrate this. We call this the kite diagram. This helps to show the different types of influence you can have. A lot of times when people first get exposed to this, they get worried that this is more of a popularity contest than a proper analytics process. The thing is, though, the responses that everybody gives, it creates that network diagram like we saw at the beginning. In that network diagram, depending upon where you are, you're going to have different abilities. So a connector, that's the person who has the most direct relationships. So if you need to get the word out quickly to someone with, directly really fast, yeah, like a connector is going to be able to talk to lots of different people. That being said, your broker, if you want to get information to people all across an organization, brokers are the folks who connect otherwise disconnected people or groups, right? You might have a person who only has two connections, but if they're the person who has the primary relationship between your office in the U.S. and your office in Asia, you're going to have a really hard time if they were to leave, become disengaged or not care, get hit by a bus, what have you. And that's where a lot of organizations run into trouble, is they don't know who those people are, and then when they leave, they're in massive, massive trouble. Sensors, for instance, is another example. It's looking at how many steps away you are from everybody else. So we actually use sensors a lot to get the word out, if it's from a longer campaign, or also to gather information. Those folks are incredible for focus groups, because they sit in points in the network where they happen to hear about things before anyone else. Now, how does this get integrated into the different processes? So I'll walk you through a couple cases around talent management, change management, succession planning, et cetera. What we're finding is generally it's combining that relational data set with the attribute data that's really powerful. So I mentioned earlier document improving engagement, knowing which groups are high influence, high engagement, but we're doing this in talent as well. So a case I'll walk you through real quick, we actually help one of the largest utility companies in the US. They have a really tricky problem with talent. And the problem they have is they can't retain young people because in order to get promotions and be able to work on all the cool problems, you tend to have to work at this company for like 20 to 30 years. So a lot of the folks who they've identified as high performers and possibly high potentials, they're leaving the company because they're not getting the opportunity that make them stay. So they called us in and we looked at the process they had, and every year they'd spend 6 months identifying high potentials. And the way they would do it is they would basically email all the different managers and say, hey, who are your young people who have a bright future? Now, that's better than doing nothing. But what was happening was certain managers had certain proclivities. So folks who were really extroverted would recommend extroverts. People who were specific races, genders, et cetera, look for people like them as well. A lot of the offices that were less connected to the central home office were underrepresented because the relationship with the home office and them wasn't as strong, so they didn't track them down as much. What kept happening was they had higher retention issues. So they bring us in now every year to run the survey and also to look at some digital data so that every single person has the opportunity to rate everybody else. And then we look at our high potential employees as rated by their peers. And no one person can mess up their score. You know, their boss's impact can still, like, they still use the formal processes that they had before to get some of this information. But at this stage, you might see someone who wasn't recommended, who scores off the charts, who would have been missed, now is being caught in their platform. Now, to take this even further, what we're doing is we're beginning to look at this compared to compensation. One thing that happens a lot in organizations is compensation can vary wildly by role, and it can vary wildly by division, function, et cetera, and even within, depending upon how you negotiate. A lot of the customers that we've been working with have been giving us compensation data, and we're layering on top of those social scores, and we're layering on top of the performance scores they already have. When we find someone who has high performance, high social scores, but relatively low comp, that person is at way more than double the retention risk of other employees because they one day will realize I'm getting paid the same amount as other people or less in some cases. I'm doing twice as much work. I'm more vital. I'm going to take my talent somewhere else. And we find in these companies you've got employees who are sometimes even getting paid half as much as others but are twice as vital to the social fabric based on the data we're seeing. And they have all the requisite performance scores. Really powerful stuff because typically the soft and squishy stuff that's hard to measure, that's overlooked and it's a thing that's considered okay in orgs. But that's the reason why people leave. So when it comes to the talent programs we're doing, a lot of it's looking at compensation disparity. It's looking at are we finding people from special groups who have high scores but aren't getting recognized. And then because we're measuring this year over year, it makes the process more transparent. All the employees of these companies no, this is going to be measured. Expected to share more stuff now. It's really powerful, especially in some of our organizations where there's a disconnect in what they're asking for and what they're rewarding. Another example, and we'll open up for questions in a little bit, but I'm going to go through a couple more examples and just a little bit of thing about the future. We worked with one of the top children's hospitals in the country. When we had data from the survey, we also had data from pagers, so we could see who paged who in a disaster scenario. What's really powerful is this hospital, they moved from a flat floor plan to a vertical one, so they actually have multiple floors now where before it was one big layout. Physical space is a huge impact on communication. So if you're familiar with like baby bays, those are the rooms where you see them in Well, either hospitals or if you're, you don't have a child, you can see them in movies where there's all the babies in one room. If there's a problem, a doctor or nurse can shout across the room and get another doctor or nurse. Hospitals are moving towards a model now of more privacy, where you have like single family rooms, you have private rooms for each person. It's more segmented by floor, especially in major urban areas. So before, where you used to be able to just get line of sight communication, now it's much more reliant on people actually traveling to go have a conversation, digital communication, and in those instances, people's existing relationships have a much bigger impact. So this group came to us, and they're like, you know, we're noticing that some of our response times are lower than normal. We want to figure out what's going on. So you're looking at the data, you're looking at some of the response times. We're finding that on certain days of the week, response times seem to be worse than others. So we weren't quite sure what was going on there. And when we were looking at it, you can see in the network, you've got like a green island and a purple island. And the purple group, that's the pediatric intensive care unit. The green group's the respiratory function. And most of the critical issues that children have in this hospital, they wind up being related to respiratory. So there's a lot of issues with communication to these groups. What we found was, when you looked at collaboration relationships and you looked at information sharing, there were only a couple people, and you can see the folks right on the intersection point who have all those relationships, who were brokering communication between those two groups. And the way that the community, when we interviewed people too, and the way that that communication would happen is, someone would come to them and say, hey, I've got a kid, they're going through XYZ, I have a feeling there might be an issue here, could you come take a look? So before there was a problem, they were going to those people to get feedback on what to do. Turns out, the days that they had slower response times were the days that both of those people were on leave, right, or both had a day off. Because when they didn't have those people around where they felt comfortable with hunches, nurses weren't going to other people and seeking. In which case, we get pushed through the system you're looking at. It's crazy. Just a couple people configure differently, so making sure they're not out the same day and then building relationships between other people so that they're not as reliant on those two people had a massive impact on their overall response times. And this is one of the key lessons. It's rarely that you have to reconfigure everything or reformat everything or it's all broken. Usually it's just one or two people in the wrong place, or if one of them goes missing or something like that, that one change can be either seriously positive or seriously negative. One last story, and one of my favorite ones, is we do a lot of work with large CPG companies. This is a different one, one of the ones that wasn't listed earlier. But they have a really challenging problem with innovation where they're expecting most of their revenue growth to come from new products. And when you're expecting revenue growth to come from new products, your R&D division gets slammed with lots of requests and a lot of pressure. So this R&D group, they've got about 500 people. And they preach collaboration and they preach information sharing because really good outcomes come from teams, not from individual inventors. But the problem is they incentivize on the basis of the patent system. So there's a disconnect where they're rewarding people for being that individual contributor, but then telling everyone they want them to collaborate. It's like saying, I want you to do one thing, but I'm going to reward you for doing the exact opposite of it. And they came to us because right now it takes them on average like 3 to 4 years to get a new product to market and a couple of years to get a new product change to market. Really long time, and even just like a few months on that is a dramatic competitive advantage because they can beat the competitors who might hear about their stuff, copy it, et cetera. So we want to map the organization. Like, we want to know first, who are the people who are living the behaviors we want so we can reward them? And then second, are there ways that we could shorten that time cycle? So we mapped the network, we sit down with the VP of R&D, and it was like, you know, you're not going to like this, but 35% of all of your group-to-group collaboration comes from five people. And two of them didn't even take the survey. It's other people saying these are the go-tos, and they were the only people who were connecting these two groups. So he takes a look and is like, well, this is timely. Two of them were in salary negotiations, and one of them was in talks to wind down and retire. They were looking at losing almost... You've got a group of America, and just, like, just destroyed overnight, setting them back on all those collaboration relationships they're looking for, reducing the time or increasing the time it takes for them to coordinate and figure stuff out. So we're sitting there and it's like, so you have the opportunity to incentivize and reward the people who do exactly what you want to do, and everyone told you these people are, or if they leave, everyone's going to know this stuff's not rewarded. So they took this as an opportunity to improve the compensation of those two people, so we got them to stay, got the person who's going to retire to stay on so they could pass off that work on someone where they had introed all the relationships. And then we literally looked at the next five people in line who were the next level order collaborators who we could then put in roles where they could reduce the strain on those five people who were carrying so much of the burden. When we did this, we found that a huge part of the process for getting products to the market was literally cut into about a sixth of the time it took before. So 12 months of this process typically was spent once something was decided to be put in a prototype, and then before that project actually went live, just going back and forth, communicating with these five people in the different teams and what that project would look like. There. Without getting stuck with all the heavy lifting. So for them, it was dramatic competitive advantage. And once again, it was only a couple people who incentivized the right way, once you knew who they were simultaneously holding things together and holding things back from where it could be. These are just a couple examples. So innovation, communication, and talent, where these types of analytics are starting to look at operational challenges in a different way. We're really only scratching the surface with this, so there's still a long way for it to go. But it's really powerful how this stuff's happening. So a couple of quick things that I just want to bring up that I think are really important when thinking about this for your own organization. There are three risk factors that I think are really important to consider. Quality of data, privacy and security, and misinterpretation. So the first, quality of data. People analytics, they shouldn't replace traditional management. And that's one of the things that when people see new technology, they're always like, well, can it do this? Can it do that? You know, what happens if X? New technology is not supposed to replace how you're doing stuff. It's supposed to augment it and supplement it. So quality of data is really critical, right? Like if you don't have enough people to respond with the survey, you just can't use it. For us, we can start with groups of 30% and be able to work with the data in some ways, but some things you can't do with it. Same thing with email data. Email data is super noisy. There are some providers who go and do this just with email. If it tells you someone's a broker just on the basis of email, it's totally possible that that person is just sending out bulk email to everyone is an absolute nuisance. So really making sure you understand what the data means and the quality of it is critical for anything you embark upon. And someone you hire, if you hire someone to do this for you, do it yourself, then that would be, you really want to make sure they understand that. Same thing with any vendor you work with. Privacy and security. This is a big consideration for any company at this point. But making sure that people's data is used the right way and accessed by the right people is huge. So most of our customers keep this data pretty close to their chest. It's used in coaching a lot, and it's moving towards a model where employees are able to see more and more of their data. It's a very exciting time, but it takes serious consideration around governance and how you're going to use it. That doesn't mean delay the decision, because the folks who start earlier in this are just going to be better than everybody else at it, and it's going to be critical capability that helps your company. But as you're buying this stuff, you really need to think, what are the implications for my employees? You gotta be upfront and tell them exactly what you're using the data for. That way people trust you and trust the process. When it's used wisely, employees see this as more fair than favoritism, which is currently one of the pretty much the top approach. But if you don't tell them what you're doing, you're just collecting the data willy-nilly, then you're gonna have problems. Lastly, misinterpretation. It's really easy to interpret things from these types of analyses. Sometimes you might be interpreting things that aren't there. This is where comparative analytics are huge. This is also where an understanding of the organization is huge. We take a dashboard approach because we find our recommendations to customers generally come most from their questions and feedback about the data. So we sit down and they'll explain to us why someone's disconnected. They'll explain to us why someone's a broker. They'll explain to us that somebody had a particularly awesome personality and that's why they have so many connections. It's absent of that intuition, sometimes it's easy to jump to conclusions with the data. So really treating it seriously and asking lots of good questions is critical. So how to get started on this? There's a couple different ways you can do it. You can hire internally, you can DIY yourself, so you can do it yourself, and then engage external help. So external help, someone like us, a firm to jump through lots of hoops for you. So like our customers suggest new stuff all the time, and we wind up building into our tools. It's really exciting. It's really fun. And a little bit of money means a lot to companies like us. So it's a great time where you're not really dealing with giant vendors yet. You're dealing primarily with startups and small agencies and folks like that. So it's a good time to engage external help for cheaply. Hiring internally is a great way to do it too. Hiring data scientists is extraordinarily competitive right now, but if you have a large workforce and you have the budget to do it, I know Pfizer does this, Google does this, Salesforce does this. A lot of the large technology companies have built their own people analytics team internally. It is absolutely a way you can go to build this capability. The last is do your see that there are some tools plug into Excel that are basic network analysis tools that allow you to start to measure networks and measure some of these more intangible aspects of people. They're extraordinarily powerful. There's a learning curve with them, but NodeXL is actually pretty easy to use, and there's great tutorials online. I highly recommend dipping your toes in there before you say hire an internal team. And the last slide, and then I'll open it up for questions, is where is this going for the future, right? Like I've already described a bit of where it's going today, but this stuff's going to permeate all different levels of HR and management. And there's three things that I think are going to be the biggest game changers. There's real-time analysis and feedback. So right now, organizations tend to analyze this in time slices. So we'll get all the data from last year, analyze it, present it, then we'll measure the delta between this year and last year. This is going to move to a model where employees are going to be providing data on a daily basis. Some companies already do it. Like an example, albeit a negative one, is Amazon has their employees provide a little bit of data every time they turn on a computer. And that type of model where both the companies and the individuals are getting that feedback on a daily basis is absolutely coming, and it's something to start figuring out how your company wants to manage as soon as possible. Big data analysis is the next thing. If you think about the employee like footprint that they leave, there is so much data from each employee around email, calendar, text message. And in a place like the U.S. where data laws are less strict, there's going to be a ton of companies popping up who can analyze every single aspect of big data for employees. For example, when my friends in the company, they make badges that literally track where you are physically in the company, how much you're talking, who you're talking to, your pitch, your timber, your physical orientation, everything. So that's going to be a big trend. The last thing, just to sum it up, is the cross-company analytics piece. The more companies that do this, you're going to have those universal metrics. That way you know how your employees stack up against other companies, you know how your management stacks up, and it's going to allow for much more prescriptive analysis and better recommendations on how to improve your organization. So fast-forwarding 5 to 10 years from now, these are going to become the new norm. And if there's one takeaway I hope for you to have from this presentation, it's that the earlier you start playing with this stuff, the more prepared you're going to be when it's in demand. And if you look at that, like with any other trend, like cloud and CRM, for instance, you have your early adopters, and then you have the folks who are pushed into it and are laggards at the end. The people who start early, they figure out how to govern it so that by the time it's expected, they can deploy to their whole org. They figure out how to make the good decisions and the bad decisions before every single thing makes it in the newspaper. They figure out what gives them competitive advantage so they can recruit people that their competitors don't even know they needed yet. So I highly recommend just learning as much as possible. If you can experiment in your own org with it, then great. And just be in learning mode, because I think this is really going to change how folks manage organizations and their people. So that's the presentation. There's a couple questions. Let me take a look and see what we can do. Let's see.
Back, and yes, I encourage everyone to take a moment, type in whatever you'd like in the question area. And I apologize for the echo. But
yeah,
Jack,
so how about
Jack, I have our first question.
No, go ahead.
How objective are the responses when you are rating your manager, especially in smaller companies?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So generally, you asked two things. So the first, the objectivity. The second is the size. Size is really important. So The way that we do this, we specialize in pretty large populations. So my usual deployment sizes are like 1,000 employees and above for exactly this reason. When you have a small group, this stuff gets much more sensitive because you know every person in there. So we actually, the smallest org we ever did was an 80-person elementary school, and it was by far the most messed up org we ever worked in. You had a principal and a vice principal who thought they knew everybody in the org. Their top 10 influencers they thought they had only matched two on the list that the data showed. They wound up being like the 40th percentile for influence. It's just messier because there's so much more personal stuff. So objectivity and pressure are bigger issues when you have small organizations. That being said, I mentioned Amazon earlier. Where you get into trouble is when you're asking for negative feedback on people because it creates a negative culture. So the big challenge that Amazon had was they were encouraging people to provide feedback, good, bad, ugly, whatever, and they were rewarding people when they would say something negative about somebody else. That encourages that behavior, and it's a slippery slope. When you're doing it with just positive questions, it's easier on the objectivity side because folks just assign it where they feel it's deserved, as opposed to feeling like they're put in a tough situation and they have to say something bad about somebody. So it generally tends to give us better data. At the same time, everyone's scores are also the sum of the data that everybody says about them. Right now, we do not distinguish between the scores given to managers of people versus people in general. But that's something we're learning a lot more about as we collect more data.
All right, and talk about some of the challenges people have when they're first implementing these analytics, especially when you're doing it yourself.
Yeah, the biggest problem I find is just like is actually just gathering the data. A lot of companies don't actually know who work for them. It sounds silly, but usually getting the list of people to even put in the survey tool is probably the biggest barrier we have. So the first thing I would do is just try and make sure you have good enough data to see exactly who works for you, what divisions they're from, and make sure that the data matches reality as much as possible. A lot of times you get into a company and the employees in a division will call that division something completely different than what HR calls it. So just even getting started with cleaning up some of that data to make sure that you have the right stuff to analyze is probably the biggest challenge early on. After that, I think it's the challenge would be the silver bullet challenge, which is, you know, making sure that you're not assuming this is going to solve every single problem, but that it's a tool you can bring to bear on a couple targeted ones. So we work really closely with clients to say, what are the three biggest problems you have? What do they look like? What would turn the dial up on them? And then we work really closely to make sure we're targeting those, as opposed to having a tool that can be used for 500 different things and winding up all over the place.
All right. Can you go back to the slide that had a topic line similar to it augments and does not replace? We just have someone who's interested in hearing more about the items listed under that topic.
Yeah, of course. So I talked a little bit about talent management earlier. The thing that gets me most excited about talent management is retention. So we find generally in companies that 20% of people have 80% of the relationships, which means losing any one person in that group is worth way more than their salary. It's really, really challenging. And then when you compare it to how much they're getting paid and looking at some of the other aspects like engagement, et cetera, you start to get a sense of just how much losing a couple people can really damage the org. From the change management side, we do a lot with finding influencers who can help or hinder change. So we work at several companies right now where like they have $60 to $100 million initiatives that are do or die, and they just don't know who the go-to people are. And when they do the analysis, they figure out that their change team was stuck in some little corner of the org, and it didn't have exposure in half the places where the change is going to happen. So it winds up saving a lot of time, too, because we can go from zero to seeing those people in about 30 days. And it's sort of like insurance for the big change initiatives. Succession planning, it's pretty straightforward. If someone's going to leave, you have a list of all their relationships they had to get their job done that can be given to the next person. And then you can also figure out who already has networks that look like theirs in that process. So actually, we were working with a large services company recently, and they had four candidates for a managing partner position, and the one who won out had it was a 10 percentile higher score socially than the other three candidates. So they really had the chops in the org to get more stuff done, and that was the deciding factor. Onboarding, same way. This is one of the ones we don't spend as much time on, but I think it's really powerful for the future. It's when you bring a new employee on, having them spend time with influencers and well-connected people in the org early, so they have a sense of where they fit in, they can see the strategy, and also so that they're less likely to be isolated and then leave. And when you look at why people leave, folks who are isolated tend to leave a lot more often. And then communication and collaboration, sort of the underpinning of the whole thing. To what extent are you siloed? Who are the great communicators? How do you build brokerage relationships between groups? And are there groups that are at significant communication risk because they're really siloed?
Okay, and you have some really great insights really about great employee insights engagement. About are there employee any other engagement. Ones,
are there any other ones
your big trends
your
coming
big trend
that we need
coming
to be
down the pike that we need to be aware of?
Yeah, I mean, my biggest gripe with employee engagement is people do it once every 18 months. And how you feel that day is such a big impact on, like if you're just having a bad morning and you had a bad meeting with your boss and then you have your once every 18 months engagement survey, now it sort of skews your opinion. So I think that model of doing it, once every 18 months or 2 years, I think it's going to completely die. I don't think it's going to go to weekly, but I think, like, pulse surveys on a monthly basis or, like, being able to just check off how you feel one day, like, companies like CultureAmp and folks like that are beginning to implement those technologies, I think it's going to be the norm in like 3 to 4 years across the Fortune 500. Just because engagements, it's important, but if you're measuring it that infrequently and it's self-reported, how accurate really is the data?
Okay, great. No, that's a wonderful point. And we do have
a range of
industries online.
Of
I know we have many representing nonprofit and government organizations. When will this technology start making an impact on both government and nonprofit organizations who are usually hesitant or slow to adopt new technology?
Wow, what a great question. You know, government's fun. Like, we've done some government. Like, we did some work with the European Union. We've done a lot of work in nonprofit and education. The challenge with those organizations is just how, like, all right, we did a school, but the problem we ran into is union workers, right? So union sometimes, depending on how this is positioned, unions love this or hate this. They love it sometimes because it gives them more access into where their employees fit into the organization, but also it might expose people who just genuinely aren't doing a very good job. Same thing where you've got an organization where political access and power is critical. Sometimes people don't want their relationships mapped. So there are reasons why those orgs can resist. There's also incredible opportunity to reduce inefficiency and streamline orgs that are like an absolute mess, like many government organizations. I will say there are progressive governments that are like doing really cool stuff with CRM right now and cloud-based technology. The pace is quickening. But until I think citizens pressure them more, I don't think you're going to see massive change. I mean, you can see this happening already. Like, you've got, like, look at the challenges the IRS are going through. Look at the challenges that the Department of Veteran Affairs are going through. As you have consumer demand that becomes increasingly more sophisticated, those organizations have to adapt, or they're just not going to continue to get the funding they need to succeed. And that's where tools like this will be very helpful. And I hope they buy it because we'll make a lot of money. But it might be, I would expect them to be slower to adopt than some of the other orgs we're working with.
All right, wonderful. All right, well, wonderful. Thank you so much. At this time, we don't have any additional questions. Can you let us know where we can receive more information? Again, this was recorded, so everyone can go back and review the content. Zach, how can we get in touch with you or Cindio?
You can find me on LinkedIn. Also, Cindio, if you go to our website, our blog has a ton of information. So we get published pretty regularly with thought leadership in the space. So we've been published in CEO.com, Forbes, and Inc. with thought pieces in the last 2 months. And we're always putting out cases and how-to articles. So if you're interested in learning more or at least seeing where the space is going, there's tons of stuff on the blog I think is going to be really helpful.
All right, wonderful. All right, thank wonderful. You so much, Zach,
so much
for being here today. And everyone, we appreciate you being here. We have plenty of other webinars coming up in September and October, so check those out. And I'll send out an email later today
with information
on this recording and presentation deck.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you having me.
All right, bye.
All right, bye.
Bye-bye.